Good morning. Thank you for the attention you are already giving to today's presentation. Please do remember to silence your cell phones and put them away. Here to introduce today's DeHart presenter is Evie Eagan.
Good morning. Ever since Nico and I have been kids, he's been fascinated with anything related to art. He loves to express his emotions and his beliefs through his art. In fact, if you've been looking at the posters in the hallways throughout school, all of them are hand-drawn by Nico. They all have a drawing with a quote next to it that reminds people that they are loved, or just drawings that make you laugh. Nico has always been very passionate about equality and diversity, especially when it comes to art. So here's my brother to talk to you about the importance of diversity and equality in children's film and television.
Stories play a very important role in the lives and development of children. Whether it's the lives of historical figures learned in school, the tales of knights and dragons heard in bedtime stories, or the epic battles of superheroes in comics read for fun, children consume many stories while growing up, and they can leave bigger impressions on them than one might expect. Stories can be a way of teaching children about life and the world around them, whether it's how to act around people, what's good or bad, or even what is considered typical behavior and appearance. Children often learn about the world through the arts, whether it's illustration, children's theater, or most commonly, cartoons and television. They are shown these forms of storytelling on such a regular basis that the arts become a window into learning about the world for kids. This is why it is important that the art and stories shown to them are a realistic portrayal of the world around them, the community, and their place in it. It is important to lift up an array of diverse storytellers and artists when teaching children about the world, so they see and learn all kinds of perspectives rather than just one, and can grow into respectful and understanding people. In order to easily illustrate this argument, I'm going to present it in four chunks: how children are affected by the world around them, the effect of stereotypes and tropes, the lack of representation, and the positive examples and impacts. It's important first to learn about how a child's brain is developing and how they build their knowledge and behaviors. The early years of childhood are very important in the development of a child. When the brain is not completely developed until the early 20s, a child's brain is at 90% of its adult size by the time they are 5 years old and 95% of adult size by the time they are six. Between the ages of 6 and 7, children are learning to use language skills for socializing, show more awareness of their surroundings outside of home, and have larger attention spans. They are in the middle of learning how to interact with others and understanding the world around them. They are very much in a learning phase. There are three types of behavioral learning: classic conditioning, operant conditioning, and observational learning. Children learn a lot of their behavior through observational learning, meaning they learn behaviors through observing others. Children will copy vocabulary, actions, and behaviors of the people they see around them. Imitation will start from birth. However, children understand intentional behavior at 6 months, and the process of copying doesn't mature until the child is between 19 and 24 months old. Everything young children see and hear has some influence on them, as this is when they are learning about the world and what behavior they learn to consider normal. Infants are also observed to have the ability to see and respond to certain physical differences. Kids aged 6 to 12 months are shown to have a preference for members of their racial group as opposed to others, because of less exposure to other groups. Children are already shown to exhibit implicit bias by preschool age. As observed by Dr. Kristen Schutz from the University of Wisconsin, white children at 3 years old had equal chances of choosing to be friends with another white child or a child of a different race. But by age 5, that changed, and they were more likely to befriend someone else who was white. White children in the same study were also shown to associate white faces with positive emotions and Black and Asian faces with anger. However, this preference for people in the same racial group was not shown in Black children. Children are shown to pick up on the cues given by the world around them. And when there are these biases, children will pick up on them. While children pay more attention to the behaviors of their parents, this doesn't mean they are the only influence on the child. When they are exposed to something on a daily basis, it can become part of their observational learning. 95% of children have watched television and cartoons by the age of 8 years old, and 65% of children under the age of 8 watch some amount of television daily. Children are introduced to media through cartoons and characters, and having exposure to these on a daily basis means that it becomes a subject of children's imitation and becomes something they look to learn from and imitate. These cartoons and illustrations of the world around them, as art often imitates life, and that is not untrue for animation and film. If they're consuming these illustrations and stories of the world and the people in it on a daily or even weekly basis, those stories and characters become influential in them and part of the world they learn from. Now that we briefly understand how children draw from the world surrounding them and imitate it as well, we can move to seeing the dangerous ways in which learning from cartoons can impact children. Not only do children pick up behavior from television, but it can also change the way children look at and perceive things, specifically good and evil. The Children's Television Project, CTV, by Tufts University, conducted a study where first and second grade children were presented with drawn cartoon characters they'd never seen before. They were able to easily sort them into which characters were good and which were bad. This was for reasons such as they looked like a princess, thief, etc., and that the character looked similar to characters they knew. This shows that children are able to see the trends of how certain groups are portrayed in images and illustrations and use that to judge characters they don't know by just their appearances. This can cause children to have specific visual qualities they associate with good or evil, which affects how they view characters or even people in real life. There are many specific ways in which these visual stereotypes of good and evil affect kids' ways of judging the world, but there are two particular examples I would like to showcase: the tendency for villains to have foreign accents and the clear coding of characters in cartoons. There's another study done by Tufts CTV looking into the tendency of cartoon villains to use foreign accents. The study has examined 30 shows and 1,500 characters, looking at things such as role, race, and other key qualities. They found that out of all the characters, the majority of the villains had foreign accents, the most common accent being British, while all but two of the heroic characters had American accents. Specific characters mentioned were Scar and his hyena sidekicks from the Disney feature-length animation, Lion King. Scar speaks in British English, while the hyenas speak in African and Hispanic English. Some additional examples of children's villains who have accents are Dr. Doofenshmirtz from Phineas and Ferb, Uncle Deadly from The Muppets, Jafar from Aladdin, and Nightmare Moon from My Little Pony. This isn't to say that characters shouldn't have accents other than American, but the amount of villains with foreign accents compared to the amount of heroes with foreign accents is very steep. Watching these shows and hearing all these evil characters with foreign accents can lead children to associate the possession of a foreign accent with being a villain. Secondly, foreign accents aren't the only quality media and stereotypes applied to evil. Companies that portray cartoons and children's media, especially Disney, have a dangerous tendency to queer code their villains. Queer coding is the subtextual coding of a character as queer, or giving a character traits and characteristics that suggest they are queer. This should not be confused with representation, as there is never an outright statement that this character is meant to be a symbol of representation for the queer community or confirmation that they are part of these groups, only suggestion. Characters like Ursula from The Little Mermaid, Captain Hook from Peter Pan, and him from Powerpuff Girls are examples of this, Ursula being actually based off of the drag queen Divine. These characters are given stereotypical features that are often associated with queerness, such as men showing femininity or a certain tone of voice. In the same manner as giving villains foreign accents creates the association between non-American and evil, queer coding villainous characters traits often associated with queer people to being evil and bad. The typical way to characterize villains has become more dangerous now, teaching kids what good and evil is and mistakenly mixing unrelated qualities such as being queer or foreign. If children can separate characters they've never seen into categories of good and evil based on stereotypes shown in cartoons, this shows that the association is real and can very well bleed into real life and cause problems with how children view the real world. Similarly, tropes can be harmful talks on how children view themselves. A particularly concerning example is the role that female characters have historically held in cartoons and how that can affect the self-perception of young girls. The damsel in distress trope is very common in fantasy stories, having a female character often as the victim needing rescue from a man. Many older cartoons have this Cinderella complex, portraying female characters as sufferers unable to fend for themselves. This can lead to children learning that this is the role all women fit. Disney had used fairy tales as a base for their movies for years, consistently showing children stories of women needing salvation from a man and happily ever after that usually ends in marriage. This doesn't only affect children's view of others, but their view of themselves as well. Young girls who are constantly shown stories of female characters in the damsel in distress role may apply that to themselves. When a group of children were asked what cartoon characters they liked and wanted to be, the girls gave answers such as characters from the Winx Club, Cinderella, and Snow White. When asked why, the reason given was their beauty and appearance. When young girls go to their favorite stories and cartoons for characters to look up to, there is a large array of female characters characterized by their beauty and physical appearance. This creates unhealthy and dangerous standards for these children to have, which can lead to feelings of inadequacy or insecurity. Tropes and stereotypes are not the only thing in children's media that can affect children's mindset. Actual entertainment is important too. Representation or lack thereof in film and television also plays a role in children's judgment. Underrepresenting a particular minority can cause children to view people as weird or out of place and react to the group as if they are indeed these things. Additionally, if a child is part of a minority group that is underrepresented, they can view themselves as weird or not having characters to see a certain part of themselves in. Underrepresentation has been a documented problem in the film industry, and the children's section is no different. While more recently the issue has gotten better, representation still does not reflect the way the world actually is. In 1972, a study was conducted on a sample of children's shows, and over 60% had no racial minorities at all. While more recently broader representation has improved, it still does not reflect the way the world actually is. In the CTV study conducted by Tufts, where 1,500 characters were analyzed, racial minorities were still shown to have a severe lack of presence in these shows. While 13.6% of the US population is Black, only 5.6% of these 1,500 characters were Black. This gap is the same with other racial minorities as well. Hispanic Latino people make up 18.9% of the US population, but were only represented in 1.4% of the sample. Yes, this is better than the results in 1972. However, there is still much lacking. The representation shown in cartoons does not reflect the diversity that is actually present in the real world. The stories within our show mainly have solely white characters to the point where it's an overrepresentation of this group. Perpetuating is normal, as the majority of characters are shown are from one group. While underrepresentation itself is harmful, the quality of the existing representation leaves a lot to be desired. In many cases, there is an accurate representation in a lacking quantity rather than lacking representation with that which is present being of inequality. Even when minorities, specifically racial minorities, are present in the media, it is not in a positive light. It is often that the characters or people in these minority groups are shown in a negative manner or with heavy use of stereotypes. This is present in many places and leaks into children's media as well. Minorities are often given roles of villains or side characters that are not as prevalent as the leads and are often killed off. Minority representation is also riddled with stereotypes, such as portraying Asian individuals in work-oriented encyclopedias and hardly ever portraying Latino individuals as working professionals when shown on television. These make the small quantity of existing representations still harmful, especially for children learning about the world. Children's media lacking representation is harmful, as shown by the examples given before, but there isn't only negative evidence to reinforce this need for representation. Now we get to my favorite part. Talking about the joy and positive impact children's representation in the arts actually has. For young children that are part of a minority group, seeing a character in the stories they adore that looks like them, talks like them, or behaves like them can give them so much joy. An issue is that many people view it as woke or unnecessary, raising unsustained complaints that more diversity in children's shows causes issues, when in reality, having more representation in children's media harms no one while uplifting and inspiring so many children. There's no harm brought from growing representation. To the contrary, the reaction has been overwhelmingly positive. Young children celebrating when they see a person like them in their favorite story. A strong example of this is The Little Mermaid, in more ways than one. A new live-action adaptation of the classic Disney story is coming out in the summer of 2023, and many were surprised when the first trailer showing the lead actress. Traditionally depicted as white, the protagonist, Ariel, is played by Halle Bailey, a young Black woman. Which has caused complaints from certain people, there is no evidence that there was any harm caused by this casting decision, rather the contrary. Many young Black girls were ecstatic to see one of their favorite princesses played by someone who looks like them. Parents of these children filmed these young girls' reactions and shared them with others online, and they were all of a similar manner. These kids were beaming, pointing at the screen with excitement. Quote, "Did you notice she has braids like we do sometimes?" unquote, said Liana, a 7-year-old girl whose dad showed her the trailer for the movie. A classic character like Ariel being representation for racial minority is an important shift and made so many people happy. Quote, "Seeing an actual manifestation of something you love and are passionate about makes the thing more realistic and makes you feel included. That's my hope for them," said Liana's father. Liana's father and so many other parents of these young girls were so happy that their children have this to look up to. This positive representation to make them feel happy and seen. As stated, this is not the only time The Little Mermaid has shown incredible representation for young children. In 1992, a cartoon series called The Little Mermaid was airing. It was based on the film and followed the same characters. In one of the episodes, working on a starfish, Ariel met another mermaid, Gabriella. Gabriella was a Latina deaf mermaid who spoke using ASL and had an octopus interpreter. Gabriella wanted to sing just like Ariel, and Ariel wanted to be a two-tailed dancer, so the two went on a journey to find a starfish that would grant their wishes. They found out the starfish was not magical, but this led them to realize that all they wanted was to express themselves, and they didn't need magic to do that. The character was based on a real-life fan of the original animated movie. Young Latina or deaf kids were able to see themselves in this character. They could see someone like them with their favorite character and get affirmations that they didn't need to change themselves to be special or worth loving. Gabriella smiled and danced happily with Ariel, and though she was only a small recurring character, she was a sign for young viewers that they didn't need to be anything different than themselves to be important. Sesame Street is another show that has done a wonderful job in showing how important having diversity in the stories we show children is. Sesame Street has been a beloved children's show for years, having reached its 53rd season in 2022. Throughout its entire run, Sesame Street has been teaching children and raising awareness about important topics such as racism, homelessness, respective emergency services, and divorce. They found ways to approach these topics in child-friendly ways that show children it is okay to have differences. Sesame Street has done this in many ways. They've had Muppets and guests of all colors and races. On the version of Sesame Street that airs in the Middle East and Africa, Alon Simpson, they have an HIV-positive character and a character who uses a wheelchair and crutches to get around. In all of these examples, the character is not ostracized or shown to be abnormal, but rather they are loved and embraced and illustrated as just another smiling friend to normal characters. A wonderful example of this is a newer Muppet introduced several years back, Julia. Julia is a young girl with autism who is close friends with Elmo and Abby Cadabby. She doesn't speak much, but she's very sweet and energetic and plays with all the other Muppets. When she introduced, she is painting with her friends and Big Bird meets her for the first time. Big Bird has a hard time understanding Julia as she takes a bit of time to respond or doesn't give him a high five. Alan, the owner of Hooper's store and a friend of the Muppets, explains to Big Bird that Julia has autism, as it's something she wants people to know about her, and it's not that she doesn't like him, she just may do some things differently in a way he doesn't think is normal. Big Bird comments on how she's hopping up and down while she plays tag, and he's never seen anyone play tag like that. And while it's not that he thinks it's normal, Elmo and Abby soon join along, saying how much more fun it is, and it's like a new game. It doesn't matter how they play, they're just a bunch of friends having fun. Alan explains to Big Bird as they watch the kids play tag. The show talks about the topic while still showing Julia is just a kid who may behave a little differently than people expect. She plays and laughs with all the other Muppets, and her friends Abby and Elmo are always there to help and support her. Children watching the show are taught some children may have autism or other developmental differences, but that doesn't mean they shouldn't be accepted and treated like everyone else. Though, as mentioned previously, Little Mermaid and Sesame Street have been doing a great job at representation for a while, and as time has gone on, we've gotten to see many more stories that showcase minority groups and expose children to what the world is actually like. Whether it's having a character as part of a racial minority or a character that comes from a family that is seen as less traditional, children are getting to have more shows and media to consume that can safely help them to not foster biases and grow into accepting and understanding of others. There are plenty of good examples now that are amazing stories to share with children. The classic book series, The Babysitter's Club, was made into a Netflix series recently, and while staying true to the original classic story, the show helps highlight issues that might not be shown to children enough. There are multiple queer characters, people of color, characters who don't have a true parent household, and a character dealing with diabetes. The girls and the babysitters both always live together and have each other's backs through any problems they do. Amphibia is a cartoon series focusing on a 13-year-old Thai American girl who gets transported to another world where there are talking frogs. The show treats her like the fun-loving girl she is and shows the Thai community and culture she grew up in like any other child in a childhood environment. Molly of Denali shows an Alaskan Native girl go on daily adventures with her family, friends, and dog. It's the first animated show in the United States to have an indigenous Alaskan main character. These shows illustrate things that may not be considered traditional and may be labeled as dangerous by some, but truly they're just giving kids a view into what the world is like, a large mosaic of people and stories that exist out there. As a trans artist obsessed with storytelling and the arts, it means the world to me when kids like myself and I have characters to look up to and show us we're not alone. When I've had a bad day, sitting on the couch with my mother watching Heartstopper and seeing a trans kid go to school happily feels like a warm hug. It's a huge smile on my face when my sister runs into my room telling me the protagonist in her new favorite show is a trans boy just like me. Watching someone who is like me be who they are and live and exist in a story I love just shows me I'm not alone. Childhood is a very important stage of learning, and the stories, illustrations, and characters shown to kids should reflect the diverse world we live in. Having mainstream art with stories made by people from more than just one group is essential to molding children into people who understand the beautiful differences people have. Stories should be a place of comfort and learning for children, a safe space for everyone. Having diverse characters and a diverse community of artists that showcase more than just one normal can be so beneficial to children in learning how the world is and learning our own place in it. Thank you.
Thank you all so much. Have an absolutely fabulous day.
But I'm here to
That was great speech.
Good work, team.
Yeah, but I need to.